So a couple days ago, I dropped a Twitter thread. Yes, I still call it Twitter. And I severely underestimated how many of you guys would be interested in it. But then a lot of the conversation that it drove was really interesting, and a lot of discussions that happened afterward were fun to participate in. So I figured I would drop even more of the footage here. So I'm back with more of my footage and clips from my visit to Apple's secret iPhone durability testing labs. So if you ever wondered how an iPhone gets water resistance tested or drop tested or shaken like crazy before it gets announced on stage, these are the labs where all of that happens. And then they have to connect the dots between their test results and how they actually build phones, which is fascinating. So the first thing that I saw was the water resistance testing. So I think a lot of us kind of take for granted at this point, most high-end smartphones, most flagships have IP68 ratings, but a lot of people don't actually think about it. That is a code where IP stands for ingress protection, and then the first number is for solids, and then the second number is for liquids. And so each of these numbers gets higher and higher as it's more protected against ingress. So some like earbuds or headphones, for example, you might see they are IPX4 rated. That just means they're not protected from dust, but from water, they can withstand some light splashes from any direction. So sweat. Great. So the first iPhones all the way up to the iPhone 6S were not water resistant at all, at least not rated to be. But then the first water resistant iPhone, iPhone 7, was IP67 water resistant. And then now we see everything being IP68, meaning it can literally be underwater for an extended period of time. And so this is what it looks like to actually test that stuff. There's literally specialty equipment just to torture phones with water and make sure they can survive. So lots of companies have these things, but it was cool to see it in person. So the lowest level of this test is basically a drip ceiling to simulate rain and splashing. So there's no real water pressure here, but a pass is good for IPX4 on this test. But then to simulate some water pressure, they have these jets that rotate around the device and spray it with water from all angles, into the speakers, into the earpiece, into the ports, everything. And if it's able to pass this test, that's good for IPX5. It seems so simple, but it's also pretty cool to see. I've never actually watched this happen. To turn it up to 11, they just put the phone on one end and stick basically a literal fire hose on the other end and just blast the phone with high pressure water. Kind of looks insane, but if we want our modern smartphones to be able to get splashed from any angle many times over its lifetime and survive, then it has to survive this, and then it earns its IPX6 rating. But then finally, for IPX7 and IPX8, that's full submersion. So they have some lockable sealed tanks, but some of you may already know that IPX8 is supposed to be under deep water for a long time. So they actually have this pressurized tank where they can turn up the pressure inside to simulate different water depths and leave phones in there as long as they want. So now, ideally today, if you drop your phone in the toilet or spill water on it or drop it in a lake, whatever, for as long as it's down there, it should survive. Which, again, we kind of take it for granted, but that's all the seals and the gaskets and all the adhesives and things that go into getting it to pass those tests are what get it to pass the real world tests. Now, there is an entire separate type of testing that you might have already seen on YouTube that is drop testing. And it turns out Apple has been doing their own internal drop testing for years now. So it turns out in the same building, Apple set up this full-on industrial robot by Epson that they've programmed to be a drop test robot. And then they've set it up in front of these ultra bright lights and super high speed phantom cameras pointed at the exact spot on the ground where the phone will land. So the idea here is they can program the robot to pick up the phone and drop it onto any surface. And then they can have it repeat that exact motion and that exact same drop on the exact same angle over and over again, but with different surfaces, and they can A/B test them and take a look at exactly what happens. And then those of you who are camera nerds, you already know these phantom cameras are pretty serious. I don't remember the exact frame rate they told me they were shooting at, but it's pretty incredible. You can actually see the titanium on this iPhone 15 Pro wobble on its first impact with the ground. And its second impact too. So yeah, they had all kinds of different materials to do drop tests, from granite countertops to marble to corkboard and wood, etc. They even had this massive block of asphalt just sitting there, just waiting to see how the iPhone reacts to being dropped in the streets, you know? But this is a fascinating setup. Now, of course, The fact is, most phones still just break immediately when you drop them on the ground, so I kind of wonder how much of this data is actually getting translated into real changes of phone design, but it's still cool that I got to see all this stuff. And then the hardest one to capture, for me anyway, is the shaking tests. Yeah, it's exactly what it sounds like. Shaking tests. Apple has rooms full of machines that are literally trays of devices strapped to a surface that's being shaken thousands of times at a specific frequency. It's actually kind of hard to record because if my shutter speed is at the right number, it doesn't even really look like anything's moving, kind of like how car wheels don't look like they're spinning if you have the right camera settings. But I did get a few clips where, like, I put my hand on it and you can see it's moving a lot. They're using this machine to try to simulate years of wear and tear out in the real world. Apparently, they can program in the frequency of a certain motorcycle engine or car engine or subway car or whatever constant vibration that they just want to check up on to make sure everything holds up to exposure to it over a very long time. But I really think the most fascinating thing about all this testing is they are trying, before the phone even comes out, they're trying to simulate years of wear and tear in the real world with real customers in a small room under the basement of Apple Park with, like, the machines that they've designed. It's a fascinating connection they've got to make. And I spoke to John Ternus, who's the head of hardware engineering at Apple, about this process, and he mentioned apparently they go through sometimes 10,000 iPhones prototypes before they actually ship a final phone with all this durability testing. Which sounds crazy. I don't know what number I thought it was in my head, but it seems insane that they'll make 10,000 phones to break before they ship one. And actually, while I had John there, I felt like this was a unique opportunity to ask, because I've never really heard people from Apple actually speak out about the durability, but also the repairability of the iPhone. Like, we all know Apple's reputation for repairability. Not great. Like, the iPhone is notoriously very difficult to repair. But also now it's a little clearer, because the more I've thought about it, the more it feels like, I mean, Apple's just shown me a ton of durability labs, and durability feels like it's directly at odds with repairability. Like, it actually feels like it's basically a sliding scale with durability on one side and repairability on the other. And the more durable you want to make your thing, the less repairable you're making your thing. And all these decisions that go into making and designing a product are kind of pushing it back and forth along this scale. So take a listen to this.
But sometimes, for me, I find it helpful to kind of think about the bookends. Like, if you imagine a product that never fails, right, that just doesn't fail.
Yep.
And on the other end, a product that maybe isn't very reliable, but is super easy to repair.
Right.
The product that never fails is obviously better for the customer. It's better for the environment.
Okay, it's interesting you put it that way, because on one end you have the product that never fails.
Uh-huh.
On the other hand, you have the product that can be replaced infinitely,
mm-hmm.
but it's not as reliable.
Yep.
That downside of being not as reliable comes from being infinitely repairable. But I think some would argue that the downside of being really hard to repair comes from being almost infinitely durable.
Sure, but they're not always mutually exclusive. Like, those are kind of the bookends. So let me give you, like, a couple of examples.
Yeah.
I think of battery on an iPhone as being an important one. On an iPhone, on any phone, a battery is something, if you want to extend the life of the product, that's something that's going to need to be replaced, right? Batteries wear out. But as we've been making iPhones for a long time, in the early days, one of the most common types of failures was water ingress, right? Yeah. Where you drop it in the pool, or you know, spill your drink on it, and the unit fails. And so we've been making strides over all those years to get better and better and better in terms of minimizing those failures. And I don't know how many years it's been now, but we got to a point of IP68, which is kind of a rating for water ingress, which is really impressive. And I think you get to see some of these tests, right?
Yep.
And it's great, because we get these stories of people, you know, literally, I dropped my phone in the lake. I couldn't get it for 2 weeks. I fished it out. It still works. They're super excited. That said, to get the product there, you've got to design a lot of seals, adhesives, other things to make it perform that way, which makes it a little harder to do that battery repair.
Right.
You still need to do the battery repair, so we need to make sure we have solutions for customers to do that, which we do. But it's objectively better for the customer to have that reliability. And it's ultimately better for the planet, because the failure rate since we got to that point have just dropped. It's plummeted, right? The number of repairs that need to happen. And every time you're doing a repair, you're bringing in new materials, you know, to replace whatever broke.
Yeah.
So you can actually do the math and figure out there's a threshold at which, if I can make it this durable then it's better to have it a little bit harder to repair because it's going to net out ahead.
So yeah, that checks out. I found that kind of interesting that we've never really heard anyone from Apple speak directly about this. Now, of course, in a dream world, if Apple's goal is to make the ultimate phone that never, ever breaks, then they probably shouldn't be making it from glass because, in the words of J-Rig Everything, glass is glass, glass breaks. But still, they're trying to push as far towards that end as possible, and it is interesting to hear a little bit of the behind the scenes on the philosophy there. But yeah, that's been it. That's my behind the scenes look at Apple's durability testing labs that we've never seen before. Make sure you subscribe to see more stuff very cool like this coming up soon. And let me know what you think about this sliding scale of durability versus repair. Catch you guys in the next one. Peace.